Sometimes when we wake up from dreaming, we realize that we were in some wonderful, clear space before we woke up, and we can't remember what it was like. So let us take a look at this phenomenon, because I've been experiencing this virtually every single morning. This has been going on now for several weeks, maybe 3 weeks. Incredibly wonderful dreams, where I know truth, and yet I wake up and it just, you know, it seems to dissipate. What happens? Well, I would suggest what happens is we go into this mode of explanation. If we can simply drop our desire for explanation, I believe the self-evidency of truth will simply be apparent to us. So clearly there's a level of mental activity which is obscuring the truth very clearly, and it tends to be triggered when we wake up and we start thinking about what we need to do. And oftentimes the clarity is just beneath the surface. It is just beneath the surface. So the practice would be to don't explain. Don't try to explain. So there must be some way to get into this practice. And others would say, well, if you don't explain, how can I get there? By not demanding explanation from yourself is how you'd get there. Give up the demand for explanation, because why? Truth is completely self-evident. There's absolutely no need to explain it. And again, there are those who say, well, what about those who need to, don't have the truth? Well, everybody does. So with this way of looking at it, the obscuration that everyone is experiencing comes from their desire to explain. Comes from their desire to explain. The desire to explain itself is the obscuration. The desire to explain is itself the obscuration. If we have a desire to explain, do we not have to then have automatically obscuration? Of course. What else? Why else would we need to explain? If all was self-evident, there would be absolutely no desire to explain. So the desire to explain brings about this obscuration. So in effect, give up being the guru to be the guru. The guru is not one that explains so much, although that can be a function in some way, but it's the one who shows the way to guruhood, guruness, which would be a non-explanation. Give up the desire to explain and experience it for yourself. The guru is not one that has understood an explanation. The guru is one that has dropped the desire for explanation. And in doing so, the inherent clarity of reality shines forth unobscured in their mind. That's all that anyone needs to do to be the guru, to be the one who the self-evidency of reality shining in their mind, unobscured. Give up the desire for explanation. Now, again, don't intellectualize anything. Just play the fool, play the fool, play the fool. So if all that you need to do is to convey and encourage all of us to, everyone to drop the desire for explanation, and inherently the clear light of clarity, the light of clarity will be shining in their mind, then you don't have to explain your experiencing. try to explain it. Drop it. And you're not depriving anyone of a benefit, because the benefit comes from dropping the desire for explanation. And the desire for explanation is really saying that there's someone who needs explanation. There's nothing outside of reality. All of reality is self-evident. To say that the explanation is needed is directly saying that something is outside of reality. Something is not. There's something lacking self-evidency. Reality isn't one. Something is separated. Something needs an explanation. Nothing needs an explanation. Wow, the breath is fogging up. First night is fogging up here. Okay. Obscuration. Interesting. So maybe when the breath of our mind, so to speak, meets the air, the cold air of this world, the belief system of this world, the desire to explain, the demand for explanation, it fogs up, you see, automatically it fogs up. The demand for explanation is really getting back to spirit wanting to be greater than God, saying, I want to be separate from God. And again, hiding, helping in order to hurt, saying, oh no, I just want to explain truth. there's nothing that needs an explanation of truth, actually. No one is trapped except by desire. The desire to be greater than God. Nothing is outside of our mind. There isn't any self-existent nature at all outside of our mind, outside of mind. So to be a teacher, give up desire to be a teacher. It's that simple. To help others, give up the desire to help others. Because ultimately this is what everyone must do. You have to show them what they must do. You have to show them what they must do. Give up the desire to help others. And this will sets the example. Sets the example. So if everybody just in the world just sat quietly and gave up the desire to help others, to help anyone, desire to explain anything, everybody would be enlightened, everybody would be free, just like that. Why? Self-evidency of reality would be shining in all the mind, all aspects of the mind. That would be it. And there's not something else that has to be done. There's really no one to explain to. See, there's no one to explain to. No one has left reality. No one is devoid of the self-evidency of reality. Everyone has the complete fullness of it right this moment, always will. There's never been any determinacy. Existence has never existed. Existence has never existed. Nothing is bound. Nothing is bound. A non-released event is impossible. Nothing is bound. So no explanation of how to unbind anything is needed, actually. How to unbind anything is needed. So thought clarity is not needed, actually. What did Ramana Maharshi say? Not much. Just be quiet. Thought clarity isn't needed. Certainly one of the more powerful transmissions in modern times is Ramana Maharshi and his silent gaze. Looking at that, you don't feel any words, you don't feel any concepts, don't feel any thinking going on. You just feel that there's self-evidency there. Uncaused self-evidency. Inherent. Shining self-evidency. With no effort. And he says this is always there. It's just, we're obscuring it. We're obscuring it. We're obscuring it. And so, while dreaming, oftentimes there is this very blissful clarity I have, but then it gets obscured during the day. I'm sure many have experienced this and are experiencing this. And we think here, if we don't explain, we're not doing anything. This is the modern madness. And since we're all addicted to explanation, moving our continuity, moving our comfort zone towards no explanation requires some explanation, blah, blah, blah. It's been quite difficult here in the West to duplicate Ramana Maharshi's transmission because we're so bound to words and concepts and thoughts and explanations as if we're going to transform the world. Not realizing that there isn't any world. Certainly, reality doesn't need to be transformed, right? Is there something outside of reality? No. We say the world, we're like saying, oh, there's something outside of reality, something that's problematical, something that needs to be transformed. We need to be able to explain, you know, how to transform the world. So, it's a tough sell here in the West. It is a very tough sell. But gradually we're lurching toward it. Gradually we're lurching toward it. It's not easy. It's never been easy. The self-evident doesn't need to be expressed. It is. It needs to be experienced. I mean, experiencing it is it. That is it. So, to get back to the theme, is we may be awake when we're sleeping. Paradoxically, is a paradoxical turn of speech. We may be awake while we're sleeping, and then we go to sleep when we wake up. So how to bring that awake state of sleeping into the a sleep state of awakeness? That's the trick. So one might say when we wake up, we're going to sleep. And that's true. There's nothing, no deeper sleep than active consciousness. No deeper sleep than that. So the question is, do we have to go to sleep when we wake up? And the answer from the sages is no, we don't have to actually. It's like a habit. It's like a search. We're searching for an answer, even though we already have the answer. We're trying to what? Improve upon it. Trying to make reality better, which is, again, remember, helping to hurt. Because as soon as we posit we need to make reality better, we infer that there's also a, you know, that the way it is now is not adequate. It's worse. It's not good enough. Incomplete. It's not perfect. We're saying directly it's not perfect. It is not perfect. So when we say dying, you know, you're dying to the self, dying to the self. Well, what it seems to mean is that this condition that we call waking consciousness no longer takes place in us. So I'm introducing this here as a wow factor. Again, this is practice, so we're going for a wow factor that causes us to hit the brakes a little bit. Remain full stopped, empty mind, so to speak. Neither judging one way nor the other. If you think about it, if you consider it, what if we did not go into this state of sleeping wakefulness anymore? Would we even remember what it's like? Probably not. But I say good riddance to it. It's interesting how the world markets this, the sleeping awake state, as consciousness, as awareness. And so this is what we're supposed to all get into. You know, this is like, I remember I used to try to sleep all the time. I try to somehow not, you know, get into this awake state, that we call everyday activity, we call consciousness, we call life, we call awareness. And one might say, if we don't go into this state, we might not need to sleep or rest hardly at all. It's this state that tires us out, actually. It's waking up and going into a waking sleep, a waking sleep, that tires us out, and so that we have to, you know, go to sleep. Sri Sri Anandamayi never slept, didn't need to sleep. She would lie down, close her eyes, but she said there's absolutely no change of consciousness whatsoever. Just pretending to sleep so everybody would feel like she's normal enough, you know. But she said her awareness never changed in the slightest bit. Did not need to sleep. And then she said, this is something that's very few, she said, can do this because they're still, you know, are not there yet, but it is absolutely possible. So this is a very welcome turnaround, a great turnaround, something I've been waiting to hear for a long time. The sleep problems are the worst. This is what I battled my entire life. Hideous. Talk about crippling. This absolutely hideous sleep problems. Lifetime of severe sleep problems. Trying somehow to... I know there's something wrong. I said, why am I tired? Why do I need to sleep? There's something wrong here. There's something wrong. It's the demand for this sleep consciousness, which we call wakefulness. It's really sleep consciousness, which tires us out, exhausts us. Because it's really this massive effort to distort, some tremendous fear involved. And I don't want to get up in the morning. I say, I don't want to get up because I'm having this blissful dream, and, you know, a blissful state, and I know if I get up, it's gone. So at least we're getting the turnaround here. This is very auspicious because this is getting into, you know, what do you call it? Getting into our kitchen. This is getting into the meat. This is getting into the heart of it, which is impacting how we feel in a very important way due to all the sleep disorders and depressions, etc., that are taking place in the world. Is there some hope? And it seems like there is. And I've worked my entire life on this problem. So I'm very pleased to begin to see that the turnaround is possible here. Because what good is theory if we can't sleep, you see? Or don't feel rested. The accounts of Sri Sri Anandamayi's life are truly the most extraordinary accounts I've ever come across. And I've studied all the books, I've read them, I don't have them anymore. Once I'd done it, I said, okay, I've got it, gave them away. But she literally would go around the clock, people coming to see her, 24 hours a day, for weeks at a time, without showing any visible wear. Now, eventually, the body did need some sort of break from that. Eventually, she mentioned that there's a, you know, a little adjustment or something, but the feats of just continually functioning in the most intense way without showing any diminishment at all were just absolutely astonishing. And at the same time, not really needing to eat or drink anything either. And so we say, like, wow, you know, is this some kind of city or superpower? No, not at all. This is just a direct reflection of her consciousness, the consciousness that she was the self-evidency of truth. This is just a direct reflection of the self-evidency of truth in a body, you see, with a body. The body's not separate from truth, the self-evidency of truth. Nothing is. Now, I've always wanted to just not sleep. To be able to just continuously help people, continuously help out here. But the way that I got pushed, sort of got pressured into, is to try to do it in this wakeful sleep mode, which only exhausts, makes you completely exhausted. Then you can't sleep, then you get depressed, for sure. Depression is very much a function of not being able to sleep. And then you just feel so incompetent. And you start burning out. You feel so sluggish. Everything you do is subpar. You start losing your confidence. So I think many of us who really want to help out here have gotten stuck in this situation, and we burn out and we can't sleep. We get depressed. Now what if we realize we don't need to have this wakeful sleep? Wakeful sleep. Well, that would eliminate our need for sleep, isn't it? To recover from that. Capacity to just simply allow this information just to be there and not really react to it much is very important. This is why it's coming through right now like this. That's why I say this practice is all important. Phase 4 is all about practice. I didn't used to be this way. Not at all, but so in phase 4, you may appear a lot dumber than phase 3 or phase 2 or phase 1. You may feel you may appear to be kind of stupid. Because everything is geared toward practice. Nothing else matters. And practice means to hear the good news. And what better news could there be than this terrible riddle of sleep and fatigue could be actually resolved. My entire life has been lived in this horrible abyss of fatigue, terrible fatigue, crippling fatigue. So of course I am very dedicated to resolving this question of fatigue and sleep problems. Fatigue and sleep problems, that's just the worst. You talk about being tortured, that'll do it, and then add depression and anxiety on top of that. Of course, anxiety because you're afraid you can't sleep and you're getting exhausted. Of course you're going to be anxious. How am I going to survive? How can I work? How can I compete in this world? I can barely move. I'm so tired. So but now with this information coming to light, I'm still able to just sit quietly and don't try to grab it as an attainment. Just remain calm. It's as if information, how to cure everything, has just been presented, and I just say, okay, fine, I'm just sitting here, not trying to grab a hold of it. Trusting that it is self-evident, that all truth is self-evident. Someone who has realized that the self-evidency of truth is shining in their mind, they may not have any fatigue. It doesn't mean that some greedy person said, oh, well, go to work, you know, for me and make me a ton of money then. You know, that's what I want. What they need to do is disseminate this information is what they need to do. Not be working like some tireless robot to earn some merchant fortune. But this is the mercantile mindset. They think, oh, great, I got a robot. You have to work for me. If you don't, you're insulting me, or you're denying me what I'm entitled to, and you know, oh, okay. So I find the key to real great progress is to don't try to go too fast. Let the realization sink in that the answer is available with first before trying to snag the answer. Be a patient fisherman, fisherwoman, fisher person. PC, be a patient fisher person. Okay. Be a patient fisher-er. Be a patient fisher-er. Or not. Er-er. Be a patient fisher-er. Okay. Just be patient. The fish is there. The fish is there. The fish wants to bite. See, the fish wants to bite. It's the fisher which is afraid to snag the fish. Because the fish is so beautiful, you just say, oh my gosh, look at this fish that has just come out of the water. Wow. So we keep thinking the fish is trying to avoid, you know, being hooked. No, 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 no. The fish wants to be hooked. We keep moving the hook, we keep thinking we're trying to snag the fish, moving the hook. No, we're trying to avoid snagging the fish. That's what's happening. And so just calm down and realize that it's truth is not elusive. We keep thinking that the truth is very, very elusive. No, we're the ones being very elusive. We're trying to avoid the truth. We're trying to avoid snagging the fish. At the same time, pretend to be the fisher. Oh, no, what are you doing? I'm trying to be enlightened. I'm trying to catch that fish. Are you kidding? I'm really working hard at it. I'm trying to lure it, but it's very tough. I can't. No, we're trying to avoid it. But all while pretending to be trying to snag the fish. Because if it was evident that we're avoiding the fish, then we'd say, well, why? Oh, continuity fear. We'd be face to face with, well, wow, why am I doing this? So we admit it here, we have a continuity fear, so we admit we're trying to avoid snagging that fish. So the key is steady your nerves and stop pulling the hook away. Every time the fish goes to get it, we pull the hook away, you know? Just stay calm and steady. This is the key. Don't have to move the hook. We don't have to snag the fish. This fish will snag itself. Fish wants to get hooked. Then, there's the fish. We have the fish. What is the fish? Spiritual consciousness. What is the fish coming out of the water? Meaning spiritual consciousness in our lives, in our activity lives, spiritual consciousness in our activity life. That's what it means. So don't let your mind move. Practice full stop. Don't let the mind move around. for any reason. Keep the hook steady. The answer, how do you get it? You just stop avoiding it. And how do you do that? You have to evaporate your continuity fear. Which you do through four phases. There's four phases to evaporating it. At some point, you have to go into the fourth phase. Some way you have to ease into it, which is very difficult. It usually takes like a crisis to get you into the fourth phase. All the phases take crisis, but the fourth phase, I resisted it for a long time, and just the sheer desperation of my circumstances, you know, felt that just pressured me into it. And right now, again, the desperation of my circumstances, which I know a lot of people also have desperate circumstances, it's pressuring me into this, you know, into. We catch the fish, and when the fish is there, spiritual consciousness, don't try to grab it, because actually, that's actually trying to let it go. Again, just like we were trying to avoid hooking it, but pretending to be hooking it. And we pretend to be grabbing it, but actually what we're trying to do is we're trying to fumble it, you know, let it go. Oh, fumble it. Oh, it's back in the water. How did that happen? That kind of thing. So I would say the next step is just, the fish is there. Just say, okay, full stop, the fish is there. Spiritual consciousness is here, okay? Spiritual consciousness is here. Just like I turn a light on, the dark is gone. So spiritual consciousness is there, is here, and the ignorance is gone, delusion is gone. This is just like completely beautiful. You didn't see it, it's underwater. Because we wanted it to remain underwater. We wanted this duality. But we're willing to drop this duality for the non-dual. There's no reason to draw a distinction between under the water and above the water. So the fish can be both above the water and below the water. For some reason, fish symbology has always been extremely important on my path. I think Jesus is symbolized as a fish. Jesus is standing for spiritual consciousness. What do we do with this fish? Enjoy. Enjoy its beauty. That's all. It's possible the entire world gets transformed into the body of this fish. I believe it was Amitabha Buddha said that one of the ways to get to the Pure Land in Pure Land Buddhism is to visualize, see paradise all around you in this world, and the way to do that is to extend blessings to everyone in all directions, and this will transform your world into a paradise here. This is very similar, that spiritual consciousness, which is the vision of oneness, which is recognizing no exceptions and no exemptions. Everyone is inherently. Self-evidency is inherent to all. This world gets transformed into a paradise, beautiful. The form of spiritual consciousness, the form of the fish, is seen everywhere. This is very possible. Jesus constantly works with us to say, don't make any exception, not even one. It's all important. This is the key. The key of salvation is no exceptions, no exemptions, nobody is accepted or exempted. Realities for all. No one is separate. Not even, there's not even an instant of existence, not even any determinancy. There is no exception, no exemption. Super important. If you make one exemption, you're lost, deluded. So, the fish comes out of the water. Do you need explanation? No. Just enjoy, enjoy, enjoy the beauty of it. The effortless presence of the beauty. Simply enjoy spiritual consciousness. Simply enjoy it. And that's what it's there for. Because it's designed as a bridge, intermediate step to full, you know, functioning reality, which is formless, completely formless, beyond what we can even imagine at all. But so we don't need to concern ourselves with that, actually. It's this intermediate step that we're concerned with. So we can say, well, spiritual consciousness has just arisen like a fish coming out of the water, and I'm simply enjoying it is all. I'm just enjoying it. And you can, the same can happen to you. The same can come about. So again, this is a massive shift of our comfort zone that has just occurred, a massive shift. And just keep the thought, my thoughts were starting to run away a little bit, just have to bring them back. Now, it's important to say that spiritual consciousness in no way is pressing one to express this in an artistic way at all. Otherwise, it'll freak people out. What people really want to know is they'll say, why don't you, you know, express it artistically? They're trying to find out, are you being pressured? Because this is terrifying. I mean, if you've gotten had a glimpse of spiritual consciousness, the subtlety, the beauty, it's so sublime, the glory of it, you realize that it's ludicrous to even consider trying to express that artistically. But if you thought you had to, well, you're going to avoid it like the plague, because it's an impossible demand. So people are curious, you know, they don't want to admit to their curiosity. So they ask questions in a backwards way, you know. But they are, they're nervous, they're worried. Say, oh my God, I hope God isn't telling me I'm supposed to now convert and transcribe all this what I'm experiencing into some sort of material, you know, form, you know, give some form to it, or determinate form or something. Oh my gosh, no, they're scared of that. All the while pretending that's what they want, but that's how the mind is very clever, like that, sort of obscuring what the fear is. Oh, why don't you give us, why don't you show us what it's like? They're asking, oh, come on, we want to know. What they're really saying is, are you getting any pressure? Are you getting any pressure? Are you getting any pressure? Because we don't want pressure. So if you say, oh yeah, let me try. And they go, oh my gosh, he's getting pressure. You know, no, I don't want that. I don't want, it's too much for me, too much. I'll be completely enslaved by this desire to transcribe it into music or something. Oh my gosh, you know, horrible. A But nothing that frightens us more than to think that there's going to be some demand that we somehow transcribe it for so everybody can hear it, like it's our job to do that. There's no such job like that. No such job. Just enjoy it. Enjoy it all the time. And then you're showing others that they can enjoy it all the time too. Do you really think that it's experiencing spiritual consciousness that all they want to do is figure out, well, how can I like put that into a piano sonata or something? Do you really think, no way, nobody's going to be thinking that way. That's the last thing they would want to think about. They want to enjoy it all the time. They don't want to be, you know, hold themselves up in some cave and try to figure out, you know, some sort of way of putting on a concert so people can experience, you know, get some taste. No. Enjoy it all the time. So set that example. Enjoy it all the time. Enjoy it all the time. And that was what it will interest people. See, Sri Sri Anandamayi was very interesting to me. I said, wow, she's enjoying it all the time. There's no break at all. It's just sitting there. Yeah, just sitting there. I said, I'd like that. That's what I want, for sure. That's what we really want. We're just afraid to think of that. Well, maybe God wants determinacy from me. I'm going to have to somehow figure out how to turn that into determinacy. You know, give the illusion of determinacy to it all. No. That's not what God wants. So, this is part of our mind saying, what in the world are we doing here? And another part saying, no, I get this, I get it. And so, familiarity. You might not think you're getting much, but later on, you might go back and listen and say, wow, yeah, I understand, I get that. That's not difficult. Familiarity has set in. Familiar with it all. Feeling a little more familiar with it. We're sort of tying it all together here. You know, and getting familiar with having it all tied all together. Having it all, the whole thing. Oh yeah, now I get why this happened. Now I understand a kind of the attraction of the spiritual path. How it presented itself as attractive. Now I see, oh, okay, that's great. just another step of familiarity. That's the way to make super fast progress, just like this. And we're certainly doing that. So, very great. Very great, very great. May all beings enjoy spiritual consciousness right this instant. Permanently. That's it.